Is it recording?
Yeah, recording.
We got it? Okay.
Can you even see the board?
We're talking about tropisms today. A tropism is a plant movement, and it's caused by these hormones. So, as you can see, this plant is bending toward the light. This is an example of what we call phototropism. Hold on, let me do some erasing. Phototropism. Photo meaning light, tropism meaning a movement. Now this is actually known as positive phototropism. Positive means moving toward the light. You could have negative phototropism. Negative phototropism would be moving away from the light. You might have a plant root, for instance, moving away from the light. That would be negative phototropism. But usually roots don't respond to light, they respond to gravity, and they move toward gravity. You know what it's called if it's moving toward gravity? It's not phototropism, you know what it is? Gravitropism. And if it's moving toward gravity, do you think it's positive gravitropism or negative gravitropism? Positive gravitropism if it's moving towards gravity. Sometimes instead of calling it gravitropism, it's called geotropism.
It's not filming the board, though. Isn't?
Positive geotropism is moving toward gravity. Negative geotropism is moving away from gravity. The stem grows away from gravity. The root grows toward gravity. How does it know? It's got ways that it can figure out. It's got little, there are little tiny stones inside the cells that get pulled toward gravity. It's pretty neat. And then there's another type of tropism that we need to know. It's called thigmotropism. That's a response to touch. Plants will often move towards something they touch. Vines will especially do this. A vine will creep along, and then when it touches something, it'll grow toward it. And it'll just wrap around it. We call it thigmotropism. Have you ever seen a vine wrapped around something? Vines will wrap around things. Little, you might have seen little creeping vines on the floor, forest floor. So, this plant bends toward the light. Now, how does that work? Well, they figured out it's due to this growth hormone, auxin. If the sun's directly overhead, auxin is released, or if the light source is directly overhead, auxin is released evenly. But if the light source is on one side, like it is in this picture, there's more auxin released on the shady side. Remember, auxin's a growth hormone that causes the cells to stretch. So if this side has more auxin than this side will stretch and the plant will bend. So auxin is released on the shady side of the plant and it makes it bend, makes it grow and bend toward the light. Isn't that cool? And once it's pointing toward the light, then the auxin will start to be released more evenly, and it'll just grow straight toward the light. This is why you see plants doing this. Here's a plant exhibiting gravitropism or geotropism. If you lay a plant on its side, the stem will start growing up. The root will always grow down. You can see that on your plants. That you did, and we're going to have to go measure our plants. Does everybody have their logbook? We'll go measure them in just a minute. The root grows down, the stem grows up. That's a corn seed. Did you know that's what corn kernels are? They're seeds. Did y'all know that? When you're eating corn, you're eating seeds. Every one of those corn kernels, if you planted it, if you didn't cook it, if you planted it instead, it'd grow into a new corn plant.
Like, so is corn a
vegetable
or seed?
Both.
Wait, so like, if you were, like, took a corn kernel and you planted it,
yep,
it would grow more corn?
It'd grow a new corn plant. It's a corn seed.
Jenny, you should grow corn.
A lot of the vegetables you eat are seeds.
Jenny's
rice
garden.
Is a seed.
And you can
if you planted one rice, one grain of rice, that would grow into a new rice plant. It does have a lot of starch stored in the seed. Because that's what the little baby embryo, plant embryo, is living off of while it's growing. The seed has a lot of food stored in it. And so the little baby, the little plant embryo that grows into the plant, it lives off that food for a while until it can get big enough to make leaves. Then it can make its own food. Is this interesting, y'all?
Yes.
Here shows some plant cells up close under the microscope that are inside this plant. And you can see these little dots there. Those are little kind of like rocks. Scientifically, I think they're called statoliths. But anyway, they're pulled down by gravity. So the cells know which way is down. You can see they're all settled down to the bottom of each cell. And so each cell knows which way is down, and that can help direct the growth. 10 points, though this is a hard question, you got to think about this song. 10 points if you can tell me, if this root is growing down, where is auxin concentrated in this root? Where is the auxin? You can probably describe it in one or two words. Where is the auxin in this root if it's going to be growing down?
In the
10 points.
Oh.
If this root is turned down, where would the auxin be in this growing root? Where would the auxin be most heavily concentrated? See if y'all can get this right. It's not easy. Blue, correct.
Yeah.
Orange, not right or wrong.
There's no more things.
Almost.
Are you serious? I would go over there in that green bin and take that peach sheet of paper and tear it up. Anyone else?
Yeah.
Have any idea?
Yeah.
Think about it. The root's kind of laying on its side and it starts to grow down. Why? Where's the auxin? Yes, white is correct.
Are we white?
Yeah.
Okay.
Green is incorrect. I'm not gonna count off for this question though. Anyone else?
Yeah, hold on. Oh, I did this wrong.
You can tear them up and put them in there. Where is the auxin? That's the million-dollar question. Yes, Peach is correct. So where is the auxin? The auxin is on the top part. And that's what makes it turn down. So if I were laying on my side like this, and the auxin was on this side, and that grew, I would turn down. It's hard for me to demonstrate that. I have to have great balance. But if this side of my body stretches, then I turn that way. So if I'm laying on my side and the top part stretches, then it turns down. So that's how gravitropism works. Auxin is released on the top part of the growing root. Auxin here would be on the bottom part of the growing stem. It's the auxin that causes the plants to move. Isn't that exciting? You want to see video footage?
Yes.
Lots of video footage.
Yeah.
Enable all, not recommended, but I'm going to do it anyway because I live on the edge.
Traffic cone.
Why is this working?
You know, we actually can watch yourself. Thank you.
Oh, sorry.
After you get acrylics, your fingernails are really weak.
Observe how these pass them before the light. Now let's see what happens when that light is turned out. And another light is turned on at the opposite side. This response, bending toward the light, is called...
Okay, hold on. Can you get a light for me over there? Thank you, Avery.
Oh.
Here we go, watch.
Now let's see what happens when that light is turned out and another light is turned on at the opposite side. This response of bending toward the light is called phototropism.
Isn't that cool?
Wait, does that happen that fast?
No, it's sped up.
Here we're going to observe the effects of a plant's response to gravity. This response is called geotropism. When a plant is turned from its normal growing position, the roots will again grow downward, exhibiting a positive response toward gravity. Roots tend to grow toward the center of the earth, whereas stems show a negative response and grow away from it.
How cool is that?
Pretty cool.
Hold on, I got another one to show you.
Stimulus. Plant stems respond to light by growing toward its source. This is called phototropism. Plant roots respond to gravity. A simple experiment shows that roots always respond to gravity by growing down. This is called gravitropism. Some plant movements don't seem related to a response. These are called gnastic responses. For example, some climbing plants grow in a series of rhythmic movements that help the plant find a support up which it can grow.
What
if
you just said that? You ever seen a vine wrapped around
something? Like walking around.
That was past fun.
Now this is called a sensitive mimosa. Whoops. If you touch it, it folds up. And we call this a gnastic movement. A gnastic movement isn't necessarily toward or away from any object or anything. It's just a movement that the plant does at certain times. This thing folds its leaves up for protection. You can see here it's open, and there it's closed. It's hard for an insect to eat it when it's closed.
Ferocious spines, painful stings, poisonous sap, near perfect disguise. Plants seem to have evolved every conceivable defense for their leaves, which, by their very nature, have to be spread wide to cast a light and are therefore very visible. But this plant, the sensitive mimosa, common beside tropical roadsides, has perhaps the most radical and certainly the most dramatic solution of all.
I
One touch makes it fold its leaflets. Another tap, and it drops to the ground. How does that help? Well, watch how a hungry leaf-eating grasshopper gets on. Obviously, there's a splendid meal ahead. But before it even takes a bite, the meal vanishes.
Fold in on the grasshopper.
He moved.
But he's sitting there with a fold.
Out of the way.
Drop him.
Plants.
So all those movements are really cool. You can
botanist.
Here's a good trick you can play on your folks. When they go out of town next time, take all the plants and turn them sideways. And they'll all start growing like this. And then when they get back in town, the day before they get back, you set them all back up straight.
I think
so they're all bent, you see. And they'll go, what happened to all the plants? They're all bent. And you go, I don't know.
I love plant jokes.
Of course, you'll ruin your plants forever. They'll probably recover some. Anyway, you may not want to do it. The last thing we want to talk about in this chapter is called phytochrome. Phytochrome is a pigment in plants that tells the plant what season it is. So y'all probably know that most plants produce flowers in the spring. Do y'all know about this? Weather starts to get warm, it's real good for golf, just right about now. And the flowers start coming out. How does the plant know what season it is? Some plants go by temperature. Some plants go by amount of rainfall. But a lot of plants go by the amount of light in a day. And there's a pigment in the plants. It's called phytochrome. Phytochrome. Can you say phytochrome?
Phytochrome.
Phytochrome is a pigment that absorbs light from the sun, and it comes in two forms. PR, which is called phytochrome red, which changes to PFR, which is phytochrome far red. This pigment will absorb light from the sun and change into that pigment during the day. During the day, it changes that way. And during the night, it changes back. It changes back during the night.
What's the difference in the colors?
It's just that when this pigment absorbs light, something happens to the electron structure in the molecules, and that makes it change color. So this is a little bit different color than this, I think. I'm actually not 100% on this. But I know that this pigment changes into this pigment. I think they're different color. I think this one's red, and this one is... it might be that this absorbs red light. And if this absorbs red light, then it's kind of a bluish pigment. But one way or the other, this is a pigment in the plant that captures light and changes a little bit. It changes into that in the day, and at night it goes back. And so the plant keeps track of how much of this and how much of this are present. And it knows that way that the day is getting longer, then more of this will be produced at the end of the day. If the day is very short, you'll have less of this. And the plant has a way, has enzymes that can keep track of how much of this there is and how much of this there is, and the plant can know then if the days are getting longer. If the days are getting longer, there'll be more and more of this at the end of the day. And like I say, it's converted back at night. And so if the amount of light is less than some critical period, so this plant, this is called a cockle burr, and this is a plant that we call a short day plant. If it produces flowers, it's got weird looking little green flowers. It produces flowers if the days are short. So that's like a winter, it's a plant that flowers in the winter. So this is showing, this bar here is showing day and night. If the day is really short, this plant will flower. If the day is longer than some critical period, this line here represents what we call the critical period. If the day is longer than that critical period, it won't flower. So this is a plant that flowers when the day is short. We call it short day plant. You can also call it a long night plant. Scientists actually figured out that the length of the night is more important than the length of the day. So this conversion of PFR to PR is the important conversion here that the plant is looking at, how much of this gets converted back. But it doesn't matter. It's the same thing. If the day is short, this plant will flower. If the day is long, this plant will not flower. A clover is totally different. A clover flowers if the day is long. So here the day is longer than some critical period, the clover will flower. It's a long day plant. Here it's shorter than some critical period and it won't flower. Here's something interesting. If the day is real short, but they give it some light in the middle of the night, it'll trick the plant into thinking that the day is long. And it'll make it flower. The plant's kind of stupid, you see, and it thinks because it got some light in the middle of the night that means the day is long. And farmers can use this if they want their crops to produce flowers and fruits. You'll learn next chapter that fruits come from flowers. Did y'all know that? Fruits are made from flowers. So the flower, when it gets fertilized, becomes a fruit, like an apple comes from a flower that's on an apple tree. So anyway, if the farmer wants their crops to flower at a different time of the year, say when the days are short, they can just give them some light in the middle of the night. They can use artificial lights, big lamps, and they turn these lamps on over their fields for a short time, and that'll trick the plants into flowering, even if it's off season. How many here want to be farmers?
Jenny does.
I mean, I don't see why not.
Why not? Good job. Make a lot of money farming.
Make a lot of money.
All of my relatives, I had nine. My granddad had nine brothers. And they all got land from their dad, who was a big plantation owner. And he divided up the land amongst all his kids. And my granddad chose not to have land. He chose to go to college instead. They could either have land or go to college. So my granddad went to college. He became a doctor. And all of my relatives took the land, and they're all farmers. So there's a lot of Willis farmers in southwest Georgia. Just if you wanted to know, a lot of farmers out there. I used to go every year out there and play on the farm and hunt and fish and stuff. Okay, enough about me. What we have to do now is you're finished with the chapter. You have to read it. Chapter 39, there could be a quiz on it tomorrow. I'm not going to be here tomorrow. So there's going to be a sub. She'll come in, you might have to take a quiz over 39, and you'll start reading chapter 40 with the sub tomorrow. Is that okay? Can you handle that? And then you have need to go in there, you need to look at your plants, you need to measure them, you need to draw them if they look significantly different than yesterday.
Yeah,
get to that book. Just do what you gotta do and put it back.
You can tell.
Oh, yeah.
What is that from?